Hi, I'm Jeff Switovy, Business Unit Manager for Wax Utility Products. I'm standing here today in front of our flagship valve maintenance trailer, the Grand LX. It includes all of the features and benefits of our standard LX valve maintenance trailer, but also has the addition of a TM7 valve maintenance machine. The purpose of today's video is to serve as an orientation. I'm going to review the unpacking of the equipment, the features, the setup and the testing of the equipment, as well as all the necessary preventive maintenance that goes into maintaining a piece of equipment like this. This particular version is our gasoline powered version, which is a 77 00-26, but we also offer it in a diesel powered version, which is a 77 00-28. So when you receive your Grand LX trailer, it's to come in one of two ways. It's either going to be shrink wrapped, in which means we transport it over the road either by a tow vehicle or on a flatbed, or possibly you received it in a Connex container. So what I'm going to tell you is you'll need a box cutter if you received it through over the road transport and there is shrink wrap all over it. So be careful when you're removing it. You can typically use your box cutter and cut the straps around the outside edge and remove the entire shrink wrap all in one piece, and that way you don't have to worry about accidentally cutting into your hydraulic lines or your vacuum lines or an electrical connection or something like that. If you receive it in a Connex container, the machine will be configured in this arrangement where the ERV750 is indexed back about 15 to 20 degrees, and your TM7 is also indexed about that 15 to 20 degrees. The reason we do that is because it narrows the overall width of the trailer so it can slide in and out of the Connex container relatively easily. So what I'm gonna wanna do is place these pieces of equipment after it's been removed from the Connex container back into the normal transport position. So there will be a series of tie wraps and some blocking that secures these two devices in this configuration. You all wanna cut those tie wraps. The TM7, I'll want to loosen these clamps, one here and one here. There'll be a secondary pin location here. I'll pull this pin out, and then I'll roll the TM7 back to its normal home position and insert the travel pin back in and lock it back in place. And then the ERV750, I'll go ahead and rock the ERV750 back into place. If it's difficult, it's because the brakes are charged with a hydraulic charge, and you'll need to locate your key, turn it on, turn the switch on for the ERV750, and then hit the brake button, and you'll hear the hydraulic pressure dissipate. And then you can easily push your ERV750 back into its correct position and lock it with the travel lock. That's what you're gonna need to do in order to get your equipment back into a normal travel position. Like all of our valve maintenance systems, the Grand LX is designed to make a two-man crew extremely efficient and safe. All the features and the access points that you'll need in order to operate your equipment when you're in the field are designed so that you're accessing it either from the curbside or from the back side of the equipment. So what I'll go ahead and start, I'm gonna do a walk around here real quickly and show you, starting up at the tongue, working around the curbside, around the back side, and then some of the service points you'll need on the driver's side. Starting up here at the front, almost all of our units ship with the pintle attachment, but a 2 5/16 ball is also available. You have your safety chains, you have your breakaway battery here with a test indicator on it, so you can always make sure that your breakaway battery for the electric braking system is functioning properly. You have your 7-pin cable and its docking port so that you're not dragging it around the yard behind the vehicle when it's not being attached to a receptacle. You have a bulldog jack here in the front. And one of the things I want to mention with the bulldog jack, you do have a large range of motion in the jack itself, but you also have an index pin located here at the bottom. So a lot of times when you attach to your vehicle, you only need to crank it up a couple of turns, but then you pull the pin and raise the plate all the way up to the bottom, put your pin back in again, and that way you're not cranking your handle for the next 5 minutes to get the jack all the way up. So that's kind of a nice feature of that Bulldog jack. Also located on the A-frame of the trailer is your hydraulic breaker mount. That's located right here as well. So if you opt for the 45-pound hydraulic breaker, that secures right to the tongue right there as well. On the front of the unit, you're gonna find your 3-inch vacuum hose, and you have a series of bungees that have a quick hook on one side and a clasp on the other, so they always stay attached to the front of the trailer. The hose assembly is not stored on the spoils tank like the standard unit, because it is on the side of the trailer, and if we put the hooks on the tank door, then they would stick out probably 12 to 16 inches past the side of the trailer. So the hose assembly is stored up on the front here. We only manufacture the Grand Trailer one way, and that's with the LX features built into it. So you do have a stainless steel locking job box right here with a couple of nice gas charged shocks in there. So inside here you might be storing your HG100, some maintenance tools like WD-40, which we'll discuss later as we get into preventive maintenance. You have your hose for draining the oil on your engine. You might keep your manuals located in here. So the locking job box is nice. Right under the filter assembly for your spoils tank, we have an electric over hydraulic power unit. So although there is a hydraulic system built into the main power pack, the functions associated with your spoils tank, the sliding, the dumping, the door opening and latching, they're all controlled by a separate electric over hydraulic power unit, and that's located right here in front of the spoils tank. As I mentioned, everything is accessible from the curbside in the back. So there is a auxiliary hydraulic hose reel located right here. And although it is on the driver's side of the trailer, it's accessible from the curbside. You have your filter assembly located right here for your spoils tank. And we'll get into, when we get into maintenance, I'll cover how to service that. You have your 250-gallon spoils tank here. We have on the spoils tank itself, you have a stainless steel skirt. So in the event you inadvertently open the door before you index the spoils tank, you won't get a trailer full of spoils. You have a 3-inch ball valve here. Look, that's for dewatering of your spoils tank. We have your 4-inch vacuum hose input, and then you also have a vacuum brake. And while I'm talking about the vacuum system itself, the vacuum system is designed as the smallest point is at the very tip of your vacuum system where you're doing your excavation, and the largest point is where it enters into the tank. So your wand starts out as a 2.5-inch. It flows into a 3-inch vacuum line, and then we go from a 3-inch vacuum line into a 4-inch elbow system inside the spoils tank. So the likelihood that you ever have an obstruction somewhere downstream of the input of the vacuum system is very, 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 very unlikely. You also have a sight glass here. This sight glass is half full. You see you're at 60% capacity inside your tank. And when we get to the other side of the trailer, there'll be a chart that kind of gives you some idea of weight displacement as it relates to loading of your spoils tank as well as loading of your freshwater tank, because you can see that they are located on opposite sides of your axle, so they will affect your tongue weight. As we continue moving around the side here, we have a pressure washer hose reel. It's 50-foot line as well, just like your hydraulic one. It's on a recirc line, so right now it's plugged in to a recirc line, so the water flow, if I was to turn the water system on, or if I'm running in cold weather, the water system will continue to run from the tank up to the pump, from the pump down to the hose reel, and from the hose reel right back into the tank, so that system can keep turning over, so even in cold weather you're able to use it. As we move around the back side of the trailer has all LED lighting across the back and along the side. So you have side marker lights that are both front and rear that are LED across the back. They're all LED. You got a center marker light, LED as well as your registration tag lighting, that's LED as well. So we have the water tank located right under your top deck, and that holds about 90 gallons of fresh water. We do ship them all with antifreeze because we never know what time of year or where the unit might be sitting for any length of time. So the system will be primed and partially filled with a RV-based, water-soluble, environmentally friendly fluid. To fill that tank, there's a hole, large hole right here in the deck, and it gets me access to a 4-inch filler at the top of the tank. And the low point drain is located right here. We'll get into winterizing later. That will be something that you'll access to drain out that fresh water tank. You have your service light across the top, and that's controlled by a controller. Inside your control panel will be the selector as to whether you want left to right, right to left, in to out. Also the intensity of those lights. Typically, we just leave that defaulted for a pattern that flashes strobes from inside to out, and that way it kind of covers all your bases, as well as you have LED service lights. If you happen to be out in the middle of the night, and this gives you the ability to light the work area that you'll be operating inside of. The ERV 750, located across the back, produces up to 750 foot-pounds of torque. That gives you 13 feet of reach from its mounting pedestal, which is located right here. It has a couple of hydraulic disc brakes that allow you to position the ERV anywhere within that 13-foot radius, and when I release the brake button, it's going to lock itself in that position. The TM7 is located right in front of that. In order to use that, I'll take my ERV 750 and I'll position it out of the way, and that'll give my TM7 the ability to roll on this stainless steel track here throughout this radius and lock into a particular place. You loosen it and slide it out, and it can pull out up to 24 inches. So its range of motion is pretty much limited to within about 20 inches from the center of the knuckle to the edge of this plate throughout a radius of about 160 degrees. It produces the standard duty one, which is what we put on our trailers, produces up to 1,500 foot-pounds of torque. So twice as much power as your ERV 750. And it's kind of applied slightly different in that the TM7 clamps itself into place mechanically. It's got a very, very short reach. It's very, very stout. So when it changes directions and oscillates, it almost applies a slight, a much more positive impact to the duct valve, where the ERV 750, because of its long reach and its mechanical joint points, as it changes directions, it's a much more slow and softer change of directions. So it's a great for PM activities, where this is the TM7 is much more relevant to stuck valves. We have long tool storage located right here. There is a latch door that you can open up and access if this bin starts getting very, very full of, you know, maybe spud bars, shovels, and other types of devices. But what we ship inside there, you'll have a telescoping valve key for your ERV 750. You'll have an 8-foot long solid key for your TM7, and you have all your vacuum wands located inside of here. You have a 7/8 vacuum wand, you have a 1 1/4 inch vacuum wand, and you have a 2 1/2 inch vacuum wand, and those are all 8-foot long. While I'm under here, you also have your pressure washer wands, two of them. We have one long one and one short one. Quick pins secure them in place. The short one is used for cleaning. It produces a nice soft pattern. You can use it for cleaning your equipment. And the long one, which is about 6-foot long, is used for digging, and it's got an adjustable tip that allows you to go from a pinpoint to a slight fan, but it this is what you do your digging with. So don't use the digging wand for cleaning your equipment. You could compromise the paint and the finish that's on your equipment, as well as force water past the gaskets on your electronics. So don't use pressurized water around the electrical enclosures. As we move to the far corner over here, you have your control box. Now this is the gasoline version, so it is slightly different than the diesel, but I'll try and discuss the differences between the two right now. Across the top, you have a vacuum gauge, and this ties directly into the vacuum stream downstream of your filter. So when we are doing our vacuuming process, normal, if your vacuum is clean and it's unobstructed, you'll be pulling about 2 inches of mercury when it's running. As that filter gets obstructed and it's harder and harder for the air stream to pass that clogged filter, you'll see this around 6 inches of mercury and know that you have an obstruction somewhere. Most likely, it's your filter has gotten clogged and it needs to be cleaned and replaced. Next to it, you have your voltmeter. When I turn the key switch on, I should see about 12 volts, which is the typical resting voltage of the battery. When the engine starts and I give it some throttle, I'm gonna wanna see this voltmeter climb up to around 13.5 to 14 volts, which tells me that my charging system from the engine is working properly. We have a tachometer / hour meter here. Right now it's showing the hour meters, and as soon as I start the engine, it changes from hour meter up to digital tachometer. So for doing typical valve exercising, we're typically gonna run this thing around 1500, 1600, 1700, 1800 RPM. For doing any type of hydroexcavation or vacuuming, or if you're running your auxiliary hydraulic circuit for power tools like a breaker or a pipe cutter or a dewatering pump, we're gonna wanna run that at maximum throttle, which will correlate to a class 2 hydraulic circuit, which is 8 gallons per minute at 2000 PSI. And that's when the throttle is all the way on. When you have a diesel version, these gauges here are missing and you have a digital control panel. And so in addition to the voltmeter that you get and the hour and tach that you get, you also get your fuel level, you'll get your engine temperature, you'll get your oil pressure. Those are all built into the control panel that's used for the diesel. Across the bottom, these are the same no matter which version you get. Your next two buttons here control the spoils tank. One of them will articulate the tank out from the side of the trailer. When it reaches the end of its stroke, it lifts up to dump, and your other one opens and closes the door. So those two are located here across the bottom. The two on the right control our service light package. You got your on and off for the work lights, and then your on and off for the light bar. Located inside of here, as I mentioned, is the control box for the light bar. When it leaves the factory, it's set for center position and it's set for bright. All your fuses and whatnot for the various features inside the equipment are located across the top here, and you have a label here that corresponds to what each of these fuses relates to. Depending on which generation of these control boxes you have, you'll have either this newer style toggle for opening and closing the door, or you'll have like a screwdriver slot or a coin slot type of operation. The coin slot operation, typically if you use a quarter, you can open and close it relatively easy, but not great for tamper proof. These newer ones are much more tamper proof because they have along the side here, I can put a lock through this ear right here, and then they can't open and close it. So if you're in an environment where you're concerned about people fooling around with the equipment when it's left unattended, this version here allows you to put a lock through there. So the only switch I haven't talked about here on the front of this control panel is the one that engages and disengages your electromagnetic clutches of the power pack. We have two electromagnetic clutches that run off of that motor, one that runs the pressure washer pump and one that runs the vacuum pump. Your hydraulic pump is direct coupled, so it's always running, but the water and the vacuum pump are controlled through electromagnetic clutches. One thing I want to say before we get too far into this is that like a clutch in a manual transmission in a car, you always want to make sure that you bring the engine back down to a idle speed before you engage a clutch and then throttle back up again. So before I turn this switch, I'm going to want to push my throttle in. I engage the water system, or I engage the vacuum system, or I engage the water and the vacuum system, and then I can go ahead and throttle back up again. If you were to have the throttle all the way pulled out and activate one of these clutches, very good chance that you will damage the clutch, and that will not be covered under warranty. So very important that you are cognizant of that before you're engaging these clutches. So right above my control panel is the choke and the throttle. If you have a diesel version, you're not going to have a choke, obviously. On the front of the control panel, inside that digital display, will be a glow plug indication. And when you turn your key switch on, you're gonna wanna let the glow plug light go back off before trying to start the engine. On the gas, there's labels across the top. You have your choke here, and then your throttle. The throttle is a two-function throttle. You have a lock here for holding its position, and then I push the center button, and I can pull the throttle out, or I can push the throttle back in, or for fine control of it, I can just go ahead and rotate this. As I rotate it, the throttle comes out, or I rotate it back in, the throttle goes back in again. So that's something you may or may not be aware of that I want to touch on. So as I continue rolling around the side of the trailer here, as I mentioned, this is the driver's side. There's not a lot on this side. We don't like putting our crews onto this side of the trailer. So although there are interfaces, these are not things that are normally accessed during your preventive maintenance activities. What we have here, I'll start from the top, work my way down. This is your TM7. And I'll get into more detail on the TM7 when we get into the setup and testing. All your hydraulic control is located right here. So when my engine starts and I want to run some device, whether it be the TM7, whether it be the ERV, or my hydraulic hose reel, I'll flip the switch on, and I'll make sure my selector valve is in the right position to operate that piece of equipment. You have a couple of lights that come on. When I turn this on, the switch itself will light up, let me know that I've got hydraulic flow. You have a red light here, which is an over temperature light. This is new for this style reservoir. If you have an older Grand LX trailer, you'll have one of our reservoirs with push-pull selector valves, and it'll operate slightly differently. You'll want to make sure your selector valves manually are in the right place. You won't have these toggle switches on here. It's going to be done with manual control. And you won't have this over temperature light. You'll have to watch your thermometer on the front of your oil level gauge. And on this one, you also have a light to let you know when your fan is on. Typically, you'll hear the fan come on, but it's something that we've added in the event that the control system is telling the fan to come on, but the fan is not coming on. It's just one secondary way of determining, is it the sensor or is it the fan itself that is giving us problems. The new reservoir on the back side of this reservoir has got a drain. So when it comes time to change your hydraulic oil for the reservoir, the back side there's a drain. There's a hose shipped inside the job box that I'll show you later. And that'll connect to the back side of this, and we can go ahead and change that oil. There's clean out ports here in the front side. There's one here, I don't know if you can see that, and one located here. Suffice to know that they're there. If you've got the older reservoir, you don't have that. You've got a giant panel on the top of your reservoir, and you have to remove that panel and drain the oil out and then kind of clean inside there from the top where this has got those access panels. Here's your filler neck for adding ISO 32 oil to your reservoir. You have a pressure gauge located right here. The other style reservoir has these same features. They may be located in different spots. The fill is on top on the other reservoir, and the pressure gauge is still on the front. You have a filter access right here for this reservoir. On the old style, it's located on the side, and it's a screw-in style. Here's your temperature gauge, as well as your gauge that shows you if your reservoir is full of oil and the condition of it. Right now you can see it's very, very clear amber color. You can see it's full with a bubble at the very, very top to let me know that my reservoir is full and I've got good quality oil. And the temperature, it's ambient temperature right now, which is very, very low. It's not even showing on my scale right now. We are in December here in Chicago, so it is a little bit brisk out. So we did have freezing temperatures, so my oil is still down around 35 degrees or so right now. On the old style reservoir, this gauge will be located down inside here, and it's a little bit more difficult to see. We have here some controls for our pressure washer system. Like I said, these are things you don't normally mess with, so that's the reason why they're over here and not on the back or on the other side. We have a valve that determines where the water is being pulled from for the pressure washer. It's typically always in the main tank position. The only time you're going to go up to the top position and pull either antifreeze or water is to either recharge your system, because we let that tank, the main tank, run dry when we were doing hydro-excavation, and we sucked air into our system, and it's very hard to pull fluid from a point way down here all the way up to where the pump is located right here in a dry system. So we have a charge tank. I can go up to my charge tank, and that charge tank is located right up in the very front, and then gravity is used to get the pump wet again and allow you to get a good charge on your system. And then once you have a good charge, I go back to my main tank. We'll also use it in the in these cold months like now, where I want to winterize my system when I'm done. If I've used fresh water in the system and the trailer system is gonna be sitting outside and exposed to freezing temperatures, I have the ability to very quickly winterize the whole system by flipping it up to the top and having RV-based antifreeze up in the front. The other knob that we don't typically mess with, this is our unloader valve. And the label kind of shows you there. It's always gonna be cranked all the way to the right, and that gives me maximum 3,000 pounds of pressure out of my pressure washer system. If I'm gonna be using the water system for something else, like powering a wet saw, or I don't need the 3,000 PSI, I can go ahead and crank this the other way. And then if you're using like our diamond wire saw and you hook up a garden hose fitting to that end of the hose, I can actually supply water from my main water tank, as well as hydraulic flow, and have everything self-contained here and not have to bring a second container of water with me. As we make our way a little farther forward to the power pack itself, we have the common engine power plant. As mentioned earlier, this is the 27 horse Kohler gasoline engine. We also have a 25 horse Kubota diesel. That engine is direct coupled to your hydraulic pump located right here. So as soon as the engine's running, you have hydraulic flow. The hydraulic circuits that are on here, especially with this one, is a return to center type of manifold. So you're not building any pressure. It's not robbing your engine of any power. You have clutches that operate your pressure washer pump, or a clutch that operates your vacuum pump here. I reference these for you now in the event you do have any issues with your equipment and you're talking to someone in tech support and they want you to go, take a look at this or take a look at that. You'll know where on the equipment it's located. As we continue working our way to the front here, we have the 12 volt battery that's used for starting your engine. It's used for running the electrical systems on the lights, the hydraulic valving. Those are all run off of the electrical system supplied by this 12 volt battery here and recharged by the engine's alternator. Continue moving forward, we do have the fuel cell. It's the same virtual style for the gas or the diesel. For the gasoline version, you have a sight gauge here to tell your fuel level. On the diesel, there is a sending unit, and that ties into that same control panel, tells you your fuel level. Here's your charge tank for the pressure washer system. This is the backside of your hydraulic hose reel. Like I said, it's accessible from the curbside. I don't want people walking along the side, grabbing this on a regular basis. They go to the curbside and pay it out that way. You do have four valve crew cones. Those are stored up here in the front. So as the driver of the vehicle gets out and wants to secure the work site, he's gonna walk past this side here. He's gonna grab his cones and he'll start staking off his work area and also turning on the flasher on the back of the trailer. Just in front of the engine on here, located right below the charge tank for the pressure washer system, we have a series of reference labels here. All the stuff is covered inside your manual, but because of the importance to the maintenance of the equipment as well as the safety of trailering, we put a reference for it right here as well. It talks about the weight distribution between the spoils tank and your fresh water tank, because obviously that'll have an impact on your tongue weight, as those two are positioned on opposite sides of your axle. You also have your maintenance and your safety reference located here as well. So those are things that you're going to want to visit on a regular basis while you're operating the equipment to make sure that you're following the recommended service intervals for the mechanicals. A lubrication port right here. And this is something that we're gonna talk on later when we get into maintenance, but it's located right here above the fuel cell. It's where we'll introduce an oil solution into our vacuum stream to make sure that the vacuum pump is properly lubricated over extended periods of storage. Okay, I've kind of shown you around the piece of equipment, showed you where everything was located. So now there's a lot of things that we need to go ahead and unpack. They're put in a particular position for transport, and then we also want to check their fit to make sure everything is going to interface properly. Since we're already up here at the front of the trailer, I'm gonna wanna take this hose, the vacuum hose, I'm gonna wanna plug it into the vacuum tank, and then I'll wanna check the three different vacuum wands to make sure they actually fit inside the holder and make sure that the latch is working, all that is functioning properly. The vacuum hose is bungeed in place on the front here. It's locked in place with these clasps, so all you need to do is unhook them and let them drop. It's shrink wrapped in place right now, so I'm gonna go ahead and cut the shrink wrap. Now, those of you in the warmer weather climates will have a much easier time with this. As the temperature, as I mentioned earlier, we're here in Chicago and it's probably 40 degrees out here right now. And those vinyl on the hose get real stiff. In the summertime, this is real easy to move. Here in the winter, it kind of takes a set. So we go ahead and insert the one end of the vacuum hose into the tank, put our clamp back on again. Just an over center band clamp here. And then we have our hose assembly. Maybe the sunshine will help soften it up a little bit here, because it is a bear right now. And I've had people ask me, you know, you got a 4-inch inlet, can't we use a 4-inch hose? You think a three inch hose is difficult to move? Try and move around a 4-inch hose. So we'll want to grab the wands out of the back here, flip the lever open, and you have access to your keys, you have access to your wands. You can also just lift them out the top. What ends up happening is, right now there's a minimum amount of long tools in here right now. We just have our three wands, the 8-foot key for the TM7, and the telescoping key for our ERV750. But you'll get spud bars in there, and you'll get maybe some additional extensions for your telescoping valve key. It starts stacking up, and then you might want to, instead of trying to pull everything out of there, open up the end and just slide these out. So I'll go ahead and get one of these. There's three of them inside that bin. I'll go ahead and lay these out here so we can see them. You should have three of them. A 2.5-inch, which I just got out. That's the one you'll be using the majority of the time, is that 2.5-inch. We have a 1.25, which allows you to do some keyhole work, some buffalo box clean out. And then we also have a 7/8 wand. Now, a 7/8 wand is really great when you use a tool like the Valve Nut RX, where you're gonna replace a damaged valve nut. In order for that tool to work, the extractor needs to be able to, the arms have to be able to reach around the collar of that nut. And a lot of times, through years and years and years worth of exercising a valve, you've packed that sediment around the bottom of that valve nut. And the only way to get that out is with the 7/8-inch wand and your pressurized water. You use those together and you're able to clean out around the bottom of that, the flange of that nut. Okay, so the way these wands fit into the wand holder, this retainer right here is gonna drop right into this receptacle right here, and this pin will lock in on that recess. So what I'm gonna wanna do is, if you notice, all of our finished areas are powder coated. So this elbow itself was acid washed and is extremely clean, It's masked and then they powder coat it. But you can see this is really, really dry inside there. So if I was to slide this over the end of my wand, it sticks. It tries to bite on it. So spray a little WD-40 here on the receiver end, and this will go a lot easier. Put a little bit on my pin. We'll cover this later in the video as we get into, as we get into the preventive maintenance section of the equipment. And I'm also gonna put a little bit here on the end of my powder coated, even our wands are powder coated. There you go. Pull back a little bit. That's what you're gonna want out of all your wands. You can see my pin retracted back into its spot, so I know it's locked in place and I've got a real good fit on there. So we'll do that for the other two and make sure that those work before we put one of these in service in front of a customer. Since we don't travel with the hose installed on the piece of equipment down the road, although I do know, I've seen my guys run the hose in there, drape it down and wrap it around the front storage spot, certainly possible to do that. If you're going any distance though, you're gonna want to have the hose secured and make sure you use the travel plug. Otherwise, whatever spoils you have inside here, especially if you're getting full, as you're accelerating and decelerating and sloshing around in there, you'll have spoils running out. So install the plug back in, and once again, the band clamp goes on. There's a couple of other items we need to set up. We have the universal socket, which goes inside your ERV750. You're gonna wanna remove the pin and the gasket, and then slide your key inside the ERV750, put the gasket back on, and then slide your pin back in. And this is the way the key will stay for the remainder of its life. You end up with 30 degrees of misalignment between the socket and your telescoping valve key, and then you also have 12 inches of movement up and down. What that 12 inches of movement up and down allows you to do is, the telescoping valve key has indexes in it every 8 inches. So the 12 inch here allows the interface between the telescoping valve key and the machine to be able to have enough motion so that if you're at one spot or the other, there'll be overlap with that extension. As mentioned earlier, there is a drain hose here. This will be used for the back of your hydraulic reservoir. Mentioned earlier here, if you're ever draining the oil off the back of your hydraulic reservoir, so the very bottom there, this would go on, you'd pull the clip off and you'd turn the valve open and you'd be able to drain out your hydraulic oil if you want to change that. Same with your engine oil, same hose is used. On the block is another quick drain port. This will plug in, allow you to drain the oil to someplace safe. We also have in here your universal socket for your TM7. And this will go into an 8 foot long straight key. The TM7 doesn't have a telescoping key. We do offer as optional low clearance keys, because obviously this knuckle is pretty large, and a lot of times you'll have a valve, your valve box will be misaligned. They're a multi-piece device. You need to have the part that goes into the ground and then the part that interfaces with the head. This will be what interfaces with the 2-inch operator nut, and then this interfaces with the straight key that goes into the machine. Also located inside this job box, you have your manuals, your certificate of origins here. You'll have your manuals for the entire system. You'll have specifics as it relates to the TM7 and for the ERV750 in here. You'll have a few smaller manuals that relate to your engine and your pumps that are used in the building of this equipment. We will have a controller that operates both the TM7 and your ERV750. That's our HC100. And located inside this box, you're going to find some literature associated with your HC100. You'll have a warranty registration card. You'll have some instructions that deal with versions of the software, depending on if you're upgrading from a previous version. Sometimes that information is important. What I have inside here today for our demonstration is one more manual that we do not ship with the equipment. It's a software manual. The software manual changes all the time, probably several times per year. So we do not print the software manual that deals with the vitals control at the mobile end, as well as the vitals control on the desktop suite. So I printed it out here just so you can get an idea of how large it is. When you install the software, which you download from our website at turnvalves.com, it'll immediately open this manual, electronic version of that. You can either print it or you can just view it on your computer. But I wanted to give you an idea of the size of it, which is the reason why it's not included in hard copy. Inside of our HC100 box, you will have a RS-232 communication cable. This is a hard connection between our HC100 controller and your machine tool. It's the most reliable method for communicating between the controller and the machine. And although the equipment does have, as part of the LX package, it does have Bluetooth tethers, they're not always the most reliable. Anybody that's had a cell phone and their car not pair properly, or earbuds not pair properly, sometimes they just get finicky, and then, or you might even be in an area where there is a large amount of radio interference. Having a hard cable connection is imperative in those environments if you want to make sure your equipment's going to work. Also, if you do have any issues with the equipment, the first thing a technician is going to tell you to do is plug in hard connection. Let's eliminate some of the potential problems. Here is the HC100 data logger. It's got a large sunlight viewable capacitive touch screen on it. It's powered by a lithium ion battery. Those of you coming from some of our older equipment that use the Trimble Recon, those use NiCad battery technology. They didn't last very long. They develop memory. So you're always replacing those batteries. This lithium ion battery will typically last you about 1 week's worth of use in the field, and it'll probably last the entire life of this device. Under the HC100, we have a series of cables. You have a USB to micro USB cable connection. If you're going to transfer the data from the handheld device to your desktop computer to maintain that database, you'll either use this cable connection and use Microsoft's product called Mobile Device Center, or new, with all the new versions of our software, is the ability to do a USB transfer. So if you put a USB flash drive in here, you can then do a transfer from this device to that USB stick, and then go to your PC, put the USB stick in there, and transfer that data. And that way you can eliminate having to use Windows Mobile Device Center. We have a couple of charging options for recharging your battery. And one thing I want to state, these units come to us with a slight charge on them. They may be sitting in our inventory for some time. They don't get a full charge when they leave our factory. So before you go out and do an in-service, you're going to want to remove this device, grab your AC charger. It's a universal charger. It accepts 110 or 220 volt, 50 hertz or 60 hertz. And we have a range of international interfaces depending on what your AC network is like. So depending on where you're at, you're going to want to grab the right one, plug it into the transformer on here, and then charge your device up. We also have a DC charger. So it's got the typical cigarette lighter plug on one end, and then the small banana plug on the other end for charging your device up. So the only thing I want to really kind of state there is, you know, make sure that your device is charged before you go in the field. And I've already charged this one up before we started our presentation today. The last couple items we need to check before we get into powering everything up and making sure it runs. I want to check the fit of our keys for our valve machine. We have two of them here. I've got the telescoping key, which is used for the ERV750. That's right here. It's made up of three pieces. this in here for right now. It's made up of three pieces. Now this is our North American key, and it covers a range from 4 foot up to 9 foot. And the way it accomplishes that, I've got this intermediary section here. It's in right now, but I'm gonna go ahead and push this pin in and index this out. And as I go all the way to the end here, I'm checking to make sure that the detents are working properly, that it's latching in place, and that it's holding tight, like this one. So with this particular assembly, I can go from 4 foot to 9 foot, but if I keep adding these 3 foot sections, this piece right here, I can go from 4 foot to 9 foot, I can go from 4 foot to 12 foot, add another section, I can go from 4 foot to 15 foot, just by adding more of these sections. And that's what I stated before, you might have several of these located down inside that bin. We also have a warmer climate version of this key that goes from 3 foot to 8 foot, but also has the ability to add 3 foot sections. So you go from 3 foot to 8 foot to 3 foot to 11 foot to 3 foot to 14 foot, and you can just keep adding those sections as well. So I know these pieces all fit together very well. The only other interface I need to make sure fits together is this key itself is what interfaces with the ERV750. So I'm gonna wanna make sure it fits down inside of here. And yes, they fit together very nicely. So collapse this back down again and store this. And then we will go and check the TM7 to make sure its key and socket fit together properly. I mentioned earlier that the TM7 has a variety of keys available for use, but what ships with the machine is going to be a standard 8 foot key. And this is kind of big and bulky and heavy and awkward. And like I said, you're really only using the TM7 as a contingency tool. So what I'm gonna wanna check for, I'm gonna loosen up this lever on the side of the TM7, and I'm gonna slide my TM7 out, and I'm gonna wanna make sure the key itself fits into this knuckle. And whether you're testing it here or whether you're in the field, this is still inserted the exact same way. It's gonna be loaded from the top. It's a two-man operation. I take the key, I slide it through the top, and then when it's in there, this gets loaded up into the bottom of the key and the quick pin goes in place. I can check those independently of doing that inside the machine by making sure this fits inside of here, pushing my pin in, and I know my key and my socket are going to work. So that's not an issue. All I really need to do now is make sure this fits inside the socket. And as you can see, it does. So normally I would have it like this. I would have a worker working with me and they would install that socket on the bottom of it and I would lower it then down into the valve. This socket, like the swivel socket on the bottom of the ERV750, also has, you can see here, I've got 30 degrees of dexterity in that socket. So even though maybe I didn't get my trailer positioned perfectly and I've got my head pulled out all the way and I've got it rotated into a position where I'm going to use it, I can still be able to get onto a valve if I'm misaligned, even because of this ability of the 30 degrees here and then the swivel socket on the bottom. So these fit all together just fine. So I'll go ahead and store that back. And put this back in the job box. Okay, I've gone around and we've checked the interfaces of all the devices. They all seem to fit together very, very well. So now before I can actually make anything operate, I wanna check our fluids. We'll start with the power pack first. The first is the pressure washer pump. And you have a sight glass right here on the back, a couple of arrows, and you're gonna wanna make sure that you're dark on the bottom and light on the top. and that's the way that looks right now. The engine oil, we're gonna wanna go ahead and pull the dipstick and verify that the level of the fluid is between the F and the L, and it is, it's right to the top of the F. So we're good there. I'm assuming you're going out to do an in-service right now, so you're gonna wanna make sure you're topped off with fuel, because you're gonna be out there in the field doing, you know, a day's worth of valve exercising and vacuuming and stuff, so you wanna make sure you're topped off with fuel. On the gas version, your gauge is here. The diesel, you have to put the key in the ignition and turn it to the on position so you can see how full you are. I'm pretty empty right now, but hopefully I've got enough to do the demonstration for us. Hydraulic fluid, we talked about earlier. You can see here, on this particular reservoir, I'm gonna check it right here. On the older style reservoir, the same gauge is located up here, and you're gonna wanna make sure that you have a nice amber color filled all the way to the top. The blower itself has got two sight glasses, one in the front and one in the back of the chamber. So this is the vacuum pump here, and you can see on the very back of the case, there's a sight glass here, and then you got one right at the very front. Front one's located right below my finger here. And this uses real heavy gear oil, so you won't get an amber color. It should just be dark in color. When I turned the key switch on before, I saw my battery was charged. If you're seeing 10 volts or 11 volts, you might want to put a charger on this, because it's been sitting out in storage somewhere for a long period of time, and the battery may have run down over a period of time, or someone left something on. So when you turn the key switch on, check your voltage gauge before we go out. Make sure you have fuel. We're also going to want to demonstrate the pressure washer functions. So I like to have, this tank holds about 2.5 gallons. So this is just RV antifreeze, you know, for the potable water system. It's about $2 a gallon. You can pick it up at a hardware store, relatively easy. And then the main water tank, as I indicated before, you can see you've got quite a bit in there as well. Just make sure you've got enough to be able to demonstrate the functions of the equipment before you leave the yard. Okay, so we've checked our fluids. We've made sure everything fits. And so the equipment's all ready to go. The next step I have to do is to be able to test the hydraulic systems and the mechanical systems. You're gonna wanna find your keys for the ignition. Typically, they're stored inside the job box. If you open up your job box, right in the very front where the latch is, you'll find these keys hanging there, as well as a set of keys to lock the job box. They're both hanging on a clip inside there, but don't always rely on that. Sometimes I have found these keys attached to the engine. There's a lifting eye on the engine, they'll be attached to the top of the engine. I've even seen them mounted to the front of the radiator on the hydraulic reservoir. So those are the three places that we have over a period of time stored these keys. So you're gonna wanna recover those. First system I'm gonna wanna check is my vacuum system. The vacuum system produces about 550 CFM at about 12 to 13 inches of mercury. In order to test the system, the first thing I've gone ahead and I did was open up the vacuum brake. That's this top valve here. Make sure my dewatering valve is closed, and make sure that my plug is in the vacuum port. And I'll go ahead and start the engine then. Give it a little choke and a little throttle. Give it a second to warm up here. Now remember, when we operate this, I'm gonna want to have the engine throttled down when I turn the clutches on. Maybe leave the choke on a little bit here for a second. And you hear the vacuum turn on. I'm gonna go ahead and increase the RPM. You see my pressure gauge is relatively low. It's not all the way down because I'm only drawing air through that vacuum brake. And you can kind of hear that vacuum brake is relatively small. I believe it's only a 2-inch vacuum brake. So I am slightly restricting the airflow into the system. I'll go ahead and close it off.
And what ends up happening is, on the front side of my filter are two pressure relief valves, and they are letting air in right now. I've got no air coming through here, here, or here. All the air is bleeding in through those two valves on the other side of the filter assembly. And you can see my pressure gauge right now is about 14 inches of mercury. About 14 inches of mercury on there right now. So I'll go ahead and turn the vacuum back off. And then throttle back down again. So I know I've got good vacuum. All right, so we know we've got vacuum. The next system I want to check is the pressure washer system. And you might get a little bit of antifreeze that comes out because before these leave the factory, they are run, and this is an open disconnect valve. So you're gonna get a little bit of fluid that comes out. So I'll take a little bit of this out so I can demonstrate. And I'll grab both ones so we can see here. Here's the short one. That's the one for cleaning. And then your long one, which is your hydro-excavation wand. And as I mentioned before, this nozzle here at the end turns 180 degrees to give you either a fan or a pinpoint. So I'll go ahead and hook up one of these wands, because if I turned on the pressure washer right now, water would start flowing right out of this. It's not closed when it's disconnected. So I connect that up. Throttles down. I am in the main tank valve position. I will go ahead and turn on the water. I'll give it a little bit of gas. And you can see I had a nice soft spray there. That's what you would use to go ahead and clean your equipment with. The other thing I want to do, so I've checked the water system, I've checked the vacuum system. In order to make sure my control panel is wired properly, I'm going to want to check them both together. Let me open up the vacuum relief again, just so I don't deadhead the vacuum system. I'm going to throttle down again. I'm going to turn my vacuum and my water on. So now I've got both. You can hear the vacuum screaming away right now. We have good vacuum there. Now I just got to make sure the pressure washer still works. And that works just fine. So before I put this away, you're gonna wanna take the pressure off of it. Then you can disconnect it. And I'll go ahead and connect this back up to the recirc. And then let the line run back in. I'll also put away my pressure washer wands. Make sure you use these clips. They stop these wands from when you're going around a corner from shooting out the side. So make sure you use your clips. While I'm at the back here, I mentioned to you earlier your voltmeter on here. When the engine's not running, you turn the key switch on, you're gonna wanna see around 12 volts. When the engine's running, like it is now, you're gonna wanna see ideally over 14 volts. And right now, even at idle, I'm at 14, looks like 14 and a half volts, which is perfect, lets me know my charging system is working on the engine. So I validated my vacuum gauge, I validated my volt system, I validated the various systems on the power pack, the water and the vacuum systems. My tachometer is showing me at right around 18 RPM, 1800 RPM right now. I can check that a little bit, maybe by turning it up. And it maxes out right at 3600 RPM, so I know my throttle cable's adjusted properly. We can go ahead and check the service light bar. Turn this on, I should get my LED work lights come on. You got one there, those do tilt and swivel. So depending on where you're working on relative to the vehicle, you can adjust those to give yourself a safe work environment at night. We also have our aero board. I turn that on, and like I said, by default, it's from inside to outside. I can open this up. I can change it over to just flash. And that's giving me inside flash, then outside flash. I can go ahead and go right, or I can go ahead and go left. Like I said, we typically just leave it at center and leave it at that. So we've covered the bottom two, and those are working properly. The only thing I have left to cover is the spoils tank assembly. And as I mentioned, those run off of a separate electric over hydraulic power unit. So I'm gonna kill my engine for right now. Turn my key switch on. And now I have the ability to go ahead and articulate my spoils tank and open the door. What I wanna do before I do any of that is verify there's no obstructions in my path and that nobody is over there. Because this is the Grand LX, I can go ahead and dump this without it being secured to a service vehicle. Because it's off the side, the standard LX trailers, you're gonna wanna make sure, because they're dumping off the back and pivoting off the axle, that the tongue is attached to a service vehicle. Here, it's not necessary. So I'll go ahead and raise this first. It's gonna slide out to the side and clear the edge of the trailer. Once it does that, it reaches the end of its stroke and tips the tank up. I can go higher if I want. There's no reason, I don't have a spotter for me, so I didn't wanna keep going. As soon as it's open far enough, I can go ahead and open the door. And there you go, you dump your spoils, you get your wash down wand out, you clean the inside of it up, make sure your spoils tank has been properly cleaned. I'll go ahead and lower the tank first and then close my door again then. So I'll go down. And then close the door. And that's it as far as the spoils tank is concerned. Okay, so now we've checked out the majority of our mechanical systems. The only thing left really is the sweet spot here. It's gonna be testing our valve machines. I'm gonna test the ERV 750 first, and then I'll leave that set up and out of the way, and I'll roll the TM7 out, and then we'll go ahead and check that as well. So the first thing I need to do is grab our controller that runs both of these devices, which is the HC100. I'll grab that out of the job box here. And I'm also going to grab the control cable, because the first test I'm gonna do is always off the control cable. So I'll test the functionality running off the control cable, and then I'll check the functionality running off of Bluetooth. But first, let's get through the cable. So the RS-232 port screws into the bottom of the HC100. So I'll do that first. And this is universal between the ERV 750 and the TM7. They both have the same communication interface. I'm gonna go ahead and pull the transportation pin, move that out of the way, and I'm gonna drop the ERV arm lock. In order to do anything else, I'm gonna need to turn the hydraulic system on. But since I've got the machine in an easy to access position right now, I'm gonna move this so that you can see it. Drop that in the cradle. So when you plug the cable into the machine head, it's gonna go into one of either two ways. It'll either go down into the left or up into the right. So there is a key on the cable. I'll try up into the right, and it's not that. Down into the left. Ah, there it is. So you're gonna wanna push it in and then screw the ferrule in place. Don't try to turn the whole body. You'll end up tearing the connector apart by trying to turn this whole body. When you remove it, loosen the ferrule and pull straight out. Same thing with when you're putting it in. Push it straight in and then turn the locking ferrule. In order to do any further testing, I'm gonna have to start the engine. For the purpose of our demonstration, I'm just gonna go ahead and let it idle. But the, as mentioned, the engine is directly coupled to the hydraulic pump. So the faster I run the engine, the faster the head spins. Normal valve exercising, I'm gonna be right around, you know, 1600 to 1800 RPM. But for our demonstration here, I'm just gonna let it idle. I need to turn the power switch on, which it is. And then with this version, I gotta turn the hydraulics on. Every time I power cycle the machine, it disconnects the hydraulics. So that's one of the things that you're gonna, if you're using one of the old systems with the mechanical levers, as soon as you start the engine, you got oil at your machine. But right now I don't. So I'm gonna turn the hydraulics on and turn the selector valve over to ERV. And now I've got oil coming to the machine over here. Whenever I press this green button, it releases the hydraulic pressure and I can move the machine. When I let go of it again, it locks the machine in place. So the brakes work as designed. When you're setting up on a valve, I can go all the way to the one side if you're doing maybe a hydrant valve, or if I'm doing a transmission line or distribution valve in the street, I may flip this the other way and come around like this. And even if I don't have enough reach to get all the way into the middle of the street, you have a quick release here for the harness. You have a locking knob on the back side. You're gonna wanna loosen. And then you have a restraint pin. I pull the restraint pin and pull this out, lock my machine back in place. And now I've got that complete 13 foot of reach that I needed to get to that main valve in the middle of the street. Reverse that process. Let me put this in a position where you can see it better. All right. Okay, so as soon as you hit the power button on the lower right hand side here, depending on whether it was in shutoff mode or in standby mode, it'll either come on almost instantaneously like it did here, or it might take a few seconds for it to turn on. But in order to test the functions of the machine tool, to make sure that it didn't get damaged in shipping or freight, I'm gonna go ahead and go right to controller. And the first thing it's telling me is tap to connect. So it's telling me to try and connect to the machine. And it says a problem connecting to it. Do I want to try auto connecting? No. I'm going to go into back menu settings and get the connect screen because it was probably set up for Bluetooth during our testing in the shop. So I'm going to change this giant window here in the controller settings, hit that connect, and I've got all my options here. I've got auto detect, I've got cable connection, I've got TM7 or ERV750 Bluetooth connections. I'm gonna do cable connection first. Save. Back. Now I'll go to controller and immediately you see cable connection to ERV750 on the very bottom. So what I'm gonna wanna do is, the first thing I wanna check is my transducers right here. This is how the machine determines the amount of power it's applying, how much torque is applying. It takes a look at the differential pressure on either side of the motor. So right now, there is no pressure, the motor's not creating any back pressure. So the pressure on both sides of the motor should be the same. So if I tap this bottom bar here, I get a series of digits across the bottom here. Right now it's showing 0, 112, 112, 2, 0. The two numbers I'm interested in are the second number and the third number. And right now they're showing 112 and 112. So that means both these transducers are functioning properly. They're measuring the same amount of pressure on both sides of that motor. So I know if I do a valve exercise, I know I'm gonna be extremely accurate. Over time, since these pressure transducers use a really thin membrane of metal, and hydraulic pressure presses against that, and as it stretches, it changes the output values of these transducers. Over time, they will wear out. And you can account for some of that and adjust for some of that with an adjustment inside the control box. Most likely it's not something you want to mess with, and you'll probably just change out your transducers. But if you're doing some very, very sensitive work and you want to get the most accurate measurements, you might get two brand new transducers and you may be a couple numbers off. Well, then you might want to tweak it with that setting inside the controller, and we have a tech bulletin that shows you how to do that. But for the purposes of the type of work that we do, operating gate valves the majority of the time or some butterflies, this is going to be more than accurate. If this gets more than 10 points different when you're idling, you will get an error that comes up on the screen that says, hey, your values are way off here. You're going to want to take a look at your pressure transducers, and it'll walk you through the process of checking the quality of your sensors. So with that checked, the next thing I need to check, so now I know my pressure is going to be good, I'm going to want to check that my encoder is good. The number of times that we're counting, left counting, right counting, left counting, right, because when you're doing a valve exercise, the most important thing you're going to want to do is, did I get a full cycle? What's my math equation for turning a valve? It's 3 times diameter plus 3. So the pitch on the screw of the valve is a 3 TPI, 3 threads per inch. So a 6-inch valve is going to be 6 times 3, which gives you 18, plus some slop in that screw inside the bonnet and the packing, and plus between the screw and the gate, so you'll get another plus 3. So that comes to 21 turns. So if you want to make sure you get a full exercise back and forth and you want to do a quality check, well, it says it's supposed to be a 6-inch valve, but maybe you're getting, you know, a reading like it's an 8-inch valve or a 10-inch valve, or maybe you're getting a reading like it's a 4-inch valve. It allows you to say, hey, I got a size turn conflict, and then be able to report that back to engineering. But let me go into checking the encoder. So let me get out of here. I'm going to hit back, menu, delete activity, back, menu, delete activity, yes. And one of the other settings I have in here is diagnostics. So I'm going to turn this a little bit so you can see this head. I go to diagnostics. And the first thing they're telling me is, hey, did you read the manual? I say, yes, I've read the manual. I wrote the manual, right? So I go into diagnostics, and one of the pro tips I like to tell everybody about is there's a test for the brake system. Well, this is an area that's always exposed to the elements. It's used an awful lot. You may start getting problems with your brake button. Well, I have a virtual brake button here. I can make the brake system work without even using that button. So let's say I hit the top selection, which is brake, I hit okay. And right on my screen is a virtual brake button. So I can press this and my arm moves. I release it, it locks my arm in place. Press it again, moves my arm. I release it, it locks my arm again. So in the event you have a situation where your arm is stuck in some place because you either got a problem with your button or something else, something in the harness, you can do it virtually through that virtual brake button. So that's just a pro tip for everybody out there. The reason I'm here on the screen is I want to go to the counter test. And I hit okay. Now the counter test, what it does, and you can see this from the factory, you see a red line down here. This is when we did the factory count test at the factory. There's a red line here and a red line on the back side of the machine from when we ran that test. I don't need it. You just need any point of reference. I'm going to do 5 full turns one way, make sure that it stops at that spot, and then I'll do 5 full turns the other way and make sure it stops. That way I can make sure my encoder is working properly. So usually what I do, since I've already got this pin sitting inside here, is I'm gonna use my finger and I'll hold it right where that pin is pointing. And I got a choice here, either right hand or left hand. We'll do right hand first, and then I'll hit run. And it starts counting, and I can see the count and the movement on my screen. There's one, there's two, there's three, there's four. It should stop right within the width of my finger. And there we go. So it counted five full turns, stopped right where it was supposed to stop. Like I said, the width of my finger. Now I'm gonna do toggle left hand, make sure it does the exact same thing. Hit run. And once again, I'm gonna wanna make sure that after there's one, it makes five turns and it stops within the width of my finger. There's two. There's three. There's four. And there we go. Stop right on the width of my finger. There's 10 pulses per turn. So the resolution is 36 degrees. So the width of my finger is obviously probably less than 36 degrees on there, but that shows you how close that we're checking the position of that valve stem. So I can go ahead and hit back and exit out of here. Now the diagnostics and the vitals program themselves, although they share the same launch screen, they are separate programs. So it does put me back to the home screen, and I'll have to hit vitals again to fire up the vitals program. The next thing I want to do is check Bluetooth connectivity. So I'll go ahead and disconnect my RS-232 cable from the bottom of the HD-100 here. I'm gonna go to menu, settings, and when I hit connect up here, I'm gonna choose ERV-750, save, back. Now I can go to controller, and immediately you see it pops up with Bluetooth connection to ERV-750. So what that means now, let me do this so you can see it, get this out of the way. I can go ahead and hit start, and you can see my machine's running, and I no longer have a tether. I can go up to 50 feet away and still operate my machine tool. If I go someplace and I lose connectivity, the machine automatically stops. So it's constantly talking back and forth between the machine and the control box. The downside to doing something like this is this has your built-in GPS device. So if I'm moving around in here and I'm using the GPS that's in here for collecting the latitude and longitude for my machine tool, then I'm screwing up the position that I'm going to associate with this particular asset. For that reason, we sell a separate external GPS device that mounts like this does on a RAM ball mount. And we put a second one on the far side here. You would remove this bolt, you put another ball mount on this far side, and you would have a GPS device that stays permanently attached to your machine. So it operates independently of my valve controller. So if it's raining, or if my machine happens to be out in traffic somewhere and I don't want to be standing here and tethered to it, I can go with a Bluetooth connection, I can go over to the curb, I can go inside my vehicle where it's safe, and I can control my machine completely. And if I've got the external Bluetooth, the external GPS device, I'm collecting accurate latitude and longitude with that and not relying on where my controller is. So that's it as far as testing of the ERV-750. The next device I'm going to want to check is the TM7. Okay, now I'm going to want to test the TM7. Now, the TM7 is pretty much a contingency tool. It's for the valves you can't get because of they're frozen in place. The TM7 is going to be the one you're going to want to use because it's got twice the power, and plus because of the way it's mounted and it operates, it gives you a much more positive a cycling of a valve when it's frozen in the ground. So the ERV-750 has to be moved out of the way in order for us to test this. I'll go ahead and loosen the clamps on the roller. There is a travel pin located underneath that I'll go ahead and pull out, and it gives me the ability then to roll the TM7 around throughout its range. So you're going to kind of want to position this over a valve, roughly to the side or to the back corner of the equipment. I'm going to leave it right here so that we can actually see it from the camera perspective. I'll lock it back down in place. That locks down our radial position. Now I've still got 2 feet of linear position. I can pull this out. So I'll go ahead and slide this out and verify that operates properly. And it does. Take my cradle for my machine and I'll lock that in place. Now, once again, we're going to test this using the cable connection first, and then I'll go to Bluetooth. When you're using the automated portion of this machine, we'll want to make sure that this pressure relief valve is screwed all the way in. And it is. When it's screwed all the way in, the valving operates based on the electronics as opposed to mechanical pressure relief valves. This is a mechanical pressure relief valve. In the event you were ever to lose your controller, you can still operate this machine tool manually. And that would be to loosen this up, back your relief valve all the way out. And then when I turn the hydraulics on, I can rotate the head left, or I can rotate the head right by pressing on these knobs on either end of the valve, and I can make my machine operate. Now, you'd have to count the number of turns by watching the knuckle, and you'd have to watch the pressure by watching this gauge up here. That tells you how much pressure you're putting out. So when you back it all the way out, you try and turn it left, you try and turn it to the right, you increase your torque, you turn it to the left, you turn it to the right, until you finally get it moving. Once you're moving, then you can back your pressure back off again. I'm not going to get into that much. Beginning in 2021, all the TM7s are going to be going as pluses, which means they have a better manual control. The automation portion still works the same, but the manual portion that I just demonstrated by pushing these, there's an electrical rocker switch, the pressure gauge is more prevalent, and you can toggle between the two, and there's an electrical, a digital counter that shows you how many turns you've applied. So I'll go ahead and plug this in on the front here. I go ahead and start my machine. I need to turn the power switch on the side of the control box. And you want to make sure, in case you didn't pick up on it in the last section, that your power switch is off on the ERV750. The same holds true when you go the other way. If you're using the ERV750, you want to make sure your TM7's off. It really doesn't matter if you're using a cable connection, but once you get used to the Bluetooth connection, that's probably going to be your preferred method of connection. And if both of them are on, the machine will be confused as to which one to attach to. You might not have seen this portion before when we talked about the ERV750, but every time I turn this key switch on and off, it'll disconnect my hydraulics. So right now, when I turn the hydraulics on, I'm running the ERV, I'm running the TM7. As soon as I turn the key switch off, and turn it back on again, I have to reset the hydraulic system again. So if you're going from valve to valve to valve to valve, you'll probably just leave the engine running and not be turning it on and off all the time, and then going on there and turning your hydraulics on and off all the time. So I'm gonna go right into controller. So let's go ahead and make sure that we're connected properly, then go to menu. I'm gonna go to settings, the very top one. I'll hit the connect screen, and then I'll do cable connection again. Save. Back. Controller. So immediately it says cable connection to TM7. Go ahead and hit start. It runs a little calibration. That calibration you see in the beginning, because the TM7, unlike the ERV750, this only uses one pressure transducer. So what it does is it checks right, it checks left, it checks right again really quickly to see, hey, what's the pressure if I go this way? What's the pressure if I go that way? What's the pressure if I go this way? Because throughout the course of the day, your oil may be very cold in the morning. You may use it, it may get warmed up, it may get much, much thinner. So every time it runs a new exercise, it runs that little calibration there to say, hey, before I set my torque table, let me go ahead and check to make sure everything's working properly. So right now it's turning right, and I'm just checking my count right now. We've gone about 10 turns in the right-hand direction. The pressure transducers being different on this, it's only having one. There's nothing to really validate left or right. There's nothing for me to check there. The counter is similarly different. This uses a single proc switch. So as long as it's counting, it's gonna count both directions. Where the TM7 or the ERV750 uses two switches and a Hall effect switches. So you need to verify that in both directions. So I've gone 17 turns in the one direction. I'm gonna stop, change directions, hit start, and just make sure it counts down the other way. It obviously does that. There's not a lot that the TM7 is a much, much simpler machine when it comes to that way. So as far as complexity and things to check, there's not a lot to check here. You check that you can connect to it, you check that it turns in the proper direction, and you check that it's counting. That's gonna be about it. So I verified all those things. The only thing I really have left to do is make sure the Bluetooth attachment's working here. So I'm gonna go ahead and hit stop. And I'll hit back. I'll hit menu, delete activity, yes. And then we'll go ahead and disconnect our cable connection. And I'll put my dust cap back on again, because I'm not gonna use this again. And then I'm gonna wanna hit menu again. Now every one of these, this is the latest version of Vitals, 3.7. Depending on which version of Vitals you have, you may have a red screen on the front, you may have a blue screen on the front. So some of the menu screens will look a little bit differently, but the menu portion, going into settings, connect, and then I wanna go to TM7. And I want to hit save, back, controller again. Now it says Bluetooth connection. I hit start, does that calibration, it starts running again. So I know I'm good with the valve machine itself. So I'll hit stop. And that's what, the only thing I have left to test, and we've kind of gone down the gamut here of functionality, is the hydraulic hose reel. Now, I've tested the hydraulics on the ERV750, I've tested the hydraulics on the TM7, but I haven't tested the hydraulics under maximum load. Since I don't have anything hooked up to my hydraulic hoses, if I switch this over to hydraulic hose reel, I'm gonna deadhead my hydraulics and generate maximum pressure. So I'm gonna go ahead and do that right now. Watch your pressure gauge. And you can see, I'm right around 2,400 PSI. I've got more than enough pressure in order to run any class 2 hydraulic circuit. The other nice thing about this new manifold system, with the old lever system, when I do that deadheading of my hydraulics, there's no way to bleed that hydraulic system back to tank. So your hydraulic hoses are all charged. With this system, as soon as I went back to tank, everything opens up back, all your circuits open back up the tank and dumps all your pressure right back. So now I can hook up any hydraulic tool there and I won't have a hydraulic lock on the other side of that quick disconnect. So we've checked the hydraulic system completely and it works perfectly fine. So I'll go ahead and return my TM7 back to its storage place. I'll put the ERV back to its storage place, and then we'll go into the next section, which is going to be maintenance. Okay, we're gonna start here with the vacuum when it comes to your PM activities. Obviously, I mentioned on several occasions that the filter is gonna be a prime source of obstructions in the vacuum stream and loss of vacuum performance. So this is real easy to service. You got two 180 turn levers here that lowers the lid. And then I have a single knob here in the very center of the canister filter. So I spin this off. Remove the knob, remove the end of the canister filter, and then we're gonna go ahead and pull this cartridge off. Now there's a hook at the very back of the cartridge to help you center this in the opening for when you're reinstalling it. So when you remove it, you gotta kind of tilt the back up and then pull it forward. But this is a polyester filter. It's washable, so you can pull the cover off of it. Wash both the cover and the filter with a warm soapy water and let it dry. You should have two of these. Take your backup one and go ahead and install it in the machine. Don't take a wet filter and install it back in your machine, okay? Installing it the exact opposite way. You put it up and over that hook and it stays there. Then spin your nut back on. And then put the filter cover back on. And that's all there is to the filter portion of it. Now, as we're talking about the maintenance associated with the vacuum, the other thing that you're gonna wanna do, especially as we just spent a couple seconds talking about don't putting a wet filter in there, is if you've done some hydroexcavation or if you've dewatered a vault or something like that, you're going to want to make sure before this unit goes into storage that you at the end of the shift that you allow the vacuum to run dry for a few minutes, and we're going to open up that vacuum port, the lubrication port on the far side, and we're going to spray some WD-40 into that for about 10 seconds worth, and then we'll let it continue to be absorbed into the airstream of the vacuum and for about 30 seconds. As I walk around to the other side of the trailer, I'm gonna open up my vacuum relief. I'll have a can of WD-40 with me. I'll go ahead and start the engine. I'm gonna let the engine idle. I'll turn it over to vacuum. And then I'm gonna have to throttle up. And then located right here is my vacuum, the lubrication port. So I loosen that up. And you'll feel a vacuum, if you put your finger over it, you'll feel a vacuum on there. So I'll apply about 10 seconds with a second. And that's all there is to do as far as maintenance for the blower on a daily basis. The blower, the vacuum pump itself, it's a cast iron body, and it's a positive displacement blower. The lobes themselves are cast iron as well. So if you're vacuuming sands and rocks and dirt, not a problem. You don't have to worry about doing this. But as soon as if you go into a vault and it's full of water and you vacuum the water out, or you do hydroexcavation where you're introducing a tremendous amount of humidity into a violent spoils tank, it gets introduced into the vacuum stream, makes it through the filter, and then right into that cast iron blower. So what we're trying to do is, at the end of the day, we're gonna open up that valve, we're gonna let a dry airstream run right through that valve and through the airstream, as opposed to churning up all the fluid that's inside your spoils tank. And then I'm gonna go ahead and introduce a little bit of water dispersant and some rust preventative in through this lubrication port. And that'll prevent that blower from freezing up. Now, if you don't do this, maybe you have a condensation problem or it's been sitting for a long period of time, or you haven't done this. Do not use your clutch and your engine to try and break your blower free. You will damage that clutch. That clutch is not rated for the full power of the engine. It's rated to be able to pull the vacuum from that pump. You're gonna want to, in the event you have a stuck blower, you go to engage the vacuum and it kills the engine. What you're gonna wanna do then is you can try it a couple of times while the engine's at idle and maybe you get lucky. If you don't, this silencer screws right into the exhaust of that blower. So you just put a pipe wrench on there, a strap wrench, spin it off, take your WD-40, spray the inside of that carbon steel vacuum pump, let it sit overnight, and then use a plastic drift or a wood drift, place it on the blower and smack it with maybe a 2-pound mallet, and you'll jar those things free, and then you can go ahead and turn them by hand, and you'll have no issues then. If you break it free with the clutch, it will not be covered under warranty if you damage that clutch. Spring steel, anyways, it won't be covered under warranty. And it's very easy to tell how it failed. Okay, so now I want to kind of talk about some maintenance associated with your pressure washer. So the pressure washer, during the normal course of the season when you're actually using it and you only have potable water in there, it is a white tank, so you can see the fluid level. But it also, the problem with that is it allows the sun's rays in there, and you'll get organics growing in your water. So if you're just using potable water in there, I would say if you're not turning it over on a high frequency, you're going to want to put a little bit of bleach in that water tank. Maybe a quarter to a half a cup per full tank. That's about, like I said, about 90 gallons of water, and a quarter to a half cup of bleach inside that tank will allow it to store for long periods of time without organics growing in there. There's a filter in the bottom of that, and you don't want to get that all plugged up with organic matter that was growing in your water tank. So that's the one thing I want to talk to you about as far as the pressurized water system. The other is the winterization process. The flip side of the coin is when you're not going to be using it for a long period of time, there's something else you got to do as well. Now, even if you have potable water in there, that's fine. You can go ahead and drain that with this valve right here. It's also really handy. Once again, another one of those pro tips. If you do have potable water in there, throw some Gojo in your job box, and when you're out there in the field before you go out to lunch, you can wash your hands up, rinse them off there with the spigot, and you're good to go. Let's go ahead and talk about winterization. We'll drain the fresh water out of there. Start your engine, put it on water, let that small amount of that column of water up the tube run over to the three-way diverter valve here, let that run out, and the clutch will automatically turn off probably after about 20 seconds, and you'll be sucking air. And that at that point in time, and that's where we're going to pick up this portion of our demonstration, because I don't want to drain all that out. I'm going to show you how the winterization process goes by bringing antifreeze from the charge tank up in the front through our entire system. To do that, I'm going to switch this over to prime/antifreeze tank. And as long as I have a fair amount of antifreeze inside here. This is what we're shipping with, which is about half a tank. Normally, to fully winterize your system, I tell everyone, you know, you're gonna need about 3 gallons of RV antifreeze, okay? So we have RV antifreeze in our charge tank. Our main tank is empty. So in order for you to see what's happening, normally you just leave all your hoses and everything hooked up the way they are. But so you can see it, I'm gonna go ahead and disconnect from my recirc line. And I'm gonna, once I get it running, I'll go ahead and show you the antifreeze coming out here. But normally, if this was connected to the recirc line, it's gonna happen automatically, and you'll see pink start filling up inside there, coming from that tank, through the line, through the pump, then back over here to the pressure washer hose reel, and then back into your main water tank. So that's how you know that it's gonna be completely winterized. So I've already got it on charge tank. You're gonna wanna watch that level up there. That level will start dropping as the fluid runs through the system. I'll also lift up this hose so you can see that it's running out the hose. For this process, we can just leave the engine idling. I go ahead and click it over to water, and it's gonna start pulling from that tank. Over here, you can see the antifreeze running out the end and into my main tank. You'll also see this level dropping. You see it's dropping pretty quickly, just at idle. So I don't want to run that tank dry, so I shut it off. But as soon as you see the antifreeze, as soon as you start seeing that hose run clear, all the clear water run out of it, and start seeing pink water run through it, then you know that you've charged everything in your system and you're good to go. So I'll go ahead and hook this back up to the recirc line. The recirc line does exactly the same thing as I just did there, except it's plumbed in as opposed to me holding it up in the air for you to see. It goes right back to the main tank. Okay. So now our pressurized water system has been winterized. That's about as much maintenance as you need to do to that system. Now we kind of get into a couple of other items that you're gonna want to address periodically. Once again, the WD-40, I always keep a can of this inside my job box. There's a lot of parts on here, even though we use stainless steel fasteners and zinc iridescent chromate hardware, stainless steel where we can, we powder coat everything. There's a lot of places in here where that type of rust protection wears off over time, or you may be operating in an environment that is extremely corrosive, and even those protections don't guide you long enough. So we wanna hit certain things with WD-40. On the ERV itself, one of the things I like to hit, this is a stainless steel pin here on the travel lock, the stainless steel ball, but behind the stainless steel ball is a carbon steel spring. I don't know why they do this, but it is that way. And you're gonna want to hit this with a little bit of WD-40 once in a while. And it will make this process of sliding this pin in and out super easy. If you don't do this, that does not want to come out, and then you end up whacking your knuckles on these fittings right here. So hit that. You have this extension lock. Now this is carbon black oxide finish, which has virtually got little to no rust protection, threading into a carbon steel nut. So I'm gonna wanna hit that with a little WD-40. You have this lock, which has got a zinc coating on it. Hit that with a little WD-40. We also have the exact same lock right here. I'm gonna wanna hit that with a little WD-40. Perfect. One of the things that I can talk about, which is a challenge, the brake system on the ERV is a caliper and rotor design. Now, the calipers themselves float on this rotor on these pins. And you can see right now, these pins move really, really easy. And over time, that lithium grease that's in there that allows these pins to float, they'll eventually over time deteriorate, and you'll end up with a caliper. It's a single-sided, the pistons on the caliper only act one way. So it pushes this caliper upward and pulls the other brake so it balances that load. But if these pins are frozen, then all it does is it pulls it up and then it can't retract, the caliper can't center properly. And you're moving your arm, and even though you've got the green button pressed and the hydraulics is working fine, it's really hard, it's stiff. Well, that's because your caliper's stuck one side and the brake's dragging on that one side. So periodically, you're gonna wanna check to make sure your caliper pins turn relatively easy, like these. And you could probably brush a little lithium on there. I don't recommend WD-40 typically, because a lot of people will spray. You saw how it came out when I sprayed some of these other locations. You do not wanna get any type of oil on these rotors. If you do spray these pins with WD-40, make sure you take a solvent and clean your rotors really, really good before you go ahead and move the machine and take those pads and slide over that oil, because you'll follow the pads and then your machine's not going to lock in place anymore. On the TM7 itself, there are, because the machine itself slides in and out on guides. Show you here, it slides in and out on guides. You do have a couple of grease zerks, one here, same thing on the other side. So there's four grease zerks. You're gonna periodically want to hit those just to make sure that your machine slides in and out as freely as possible. Same thing with these are zinc plated. You may have to hit the threads and the bodies periodically with a little bit of zinc. Once again, try to keep it off the clamps, although the mechanical clamp, I guess, probably gonna be fine even if it gets a little bit of WD-40 on it. Your preventive maintenance on your engine and your pumps, you're gonna wanna follow the guidelines provided for you. We have a reference here located on the side, but also follow the instructions provided by those manufacturers. Each one's gonna be a little bit different, whether it be the diesel, whether it be the gas, you're gonna wanna follow that guidelines. Check your tire pressure, check your wheel lug nut torque. There's a note about that here on the side. We don't put the tire pressure on the sticker. We just tell you about to retighten your lug nuts. We do periodically change the manufacturer of our tires. So you're gonna wanna look at the recommendations that are part of that on the sidewall of that tire. One last thing that we could probably talk about as far as maintenance. As I showed you the pins that are zinc plated on those various parts of the machine, you have the same type of quick pin right here, zinc plated, a little bit of WD-40 on this. Makes all the difference in the world. So I'll see these things get rusty pretty quick, and then the next thing you see is this pull ring turns into an egg shape because guys are cranking on it. But just a little WD-40 on that will save you a lot of aggravation. So as we close out this video, what I want to tell you is that the technology continues to change and evolve. What you saw today in this particular orientation video may or may not match exactly what you have, whether you have an older machine or even a next generation machine. You're always going to want to resource the turnvalves.com. There you'll find the latest copies of our manual, be able to download new versions of the Vital software, as well as have the option to contact tech support or find a representative in your area should you have need further assistance. Thanks again for watching.